Hello and welcome to BYJU'S IAS. Let's take up the analysis of today's The Hindu newspaper. Pakistan's Prime Minister Imran Khan has announced the release of the captured Indian pilot, Wing Commander Abhinandan. And Pakistan has said that this is a gesture of peace that the country is making towards India. It is a gesture of goodwill that Pakistan is sending towards India in the hope that India will consider a de-escalation in tensions between the two sides. Pakistan has called upon the Indian government to make use of this opportunity, which has been offered by the release of the Indian pilot, and focus on talks and negotiations instead of escalating tensions between the two countries. On the other hand, the Indian government and as well as the Indian Air Force both have welcomed Pakistan's decision to release the Indian pilot. But the Indian government does not accept this as a gesture of peace or as a gesture of goodwill from Pakistan. Instead, India has said that Pakistan was bound to release the Indian pilot as per the norms of the Geneva Convention. And when it comes to the Pakistani offer of talks and negotiations, India has clearly rejected this offer because India has a stated policy of not carrying out talks when Pakistan continues to sponsor terrorism against India. India keeps reiterating the fact that terror and talks, they cannot go hand in hand. And India will consider negotiations only if Pakistan displays some sort of immediate, credible and verifiable action against terror groups and terror leaders who are operating out of Pakistan. Yesterday, the Indian government has even shared a dossier with the Pakistani government. This document contains a lot of evidence to link Jaish-e-Mohammed to a series of terror attacks which have been carried out against India. It also points out the connections between the state agencies of Pakistan, that is the ISI, and terror outfits such as Jaish-e-Mohammed. So if Pakistan acts on these findings which have been submitted by India, and if it takes some sort of immediate, credible and verifiable action, then India might consider the possibility of talks and negotiations. But until then, according to India, talks and terrorism, they both cannot go hand in hand. As long as Pakistan shelters terror groups, and as long as Pakistan sponsors acts of terrorism against India, the government of India will not engage in negotiations with the Pakistani government. But the Pakistani Prime Minister on the other side has denied Pakistan's involvement in the Pulwama terror attacks. He has said Pakistan has no intention of sponsoring terrorism in the region. And he is asking India to share evidence so that both the countries can take joint action against terror outfits which are operating in the region. And he has also blamed India for escalating tensions by carrying out the airstrikes. He has said Pakistan had no intentions of escalating the tensions, but it was forced to act against India because it has a right to self-defense and it had to prove its will and capability to defend its territory against Indian incursions. Now let's take up another related article. Yesterday, the Indian Armed Forces have held a rare tri-service press conference wherein senior officers from the Army, Navy and Air Force have jointly addressed a press conference in order to give some clarity with regard to the mystery surrounding the recent air-to-air combat between the Indian Air Force and the Pakistani Air Force. A couple of days back, the Pakistani Air Force attempted an intrusion into Indian airspace as a response to Indian airstrikes against Pakistan. And the Pakistani Air Force fighter jets were planning to target Indian military installations. And as we have discussed yesterday and day before yesterday, India had clearly labeled its attack against Pakistan as a non-military preemptive action. It was basically a counter-terrorist operation targeted against a terror camp, and we were not targeting a Pakistani military installation, and neither were we targeting Pakistani civilians. So India was expecting a proportionate response from Pakistan, but when the Pakistani Air Force attempted to target Indian military installation, this represented a disproportionate response against India. According to reports, Pakistan had deployed a fleet of fighter jets in order to target the Indian military installations. But the Indian Air Force, which was on a constant state of high alert, deployed another fleet of fighter jets to counter the incoming Pakistani airstrikes. So this resulted in an air-to-air combat between the Indian Air Force and the Pakistani Air Force. It is being labeled as one of the largest engagements between the two sides because multiple fighter jets were involved on both the sides. And India later reported that a MiG-21 Bison had managed to shoot down a Pakistani F-16 fighter jet. But Pakistan denied that it had deployed F-16 fighter jets against India, and it even denied that a F-16 was shot down by the Indian Air Force. So this is the reason why the tri-service press conference was held yesterday, because the Indian Armed Forces have presented evidence to prove that Pakistan had indeed deployed F-16s to target military installations in India. The Indian Air Force has collected the debris of missiles which were launched by the F-16 against Indian military targets, and they have presented debris of the AIM-120 AMRAAM missiles, which can be fired only from a F-16 fighter aircraft. The AIM-120 is an advanced medium-range air-to-air missile developed by the United States. And the recovery of the debris of this missile and the public display of this evidence by the Indian Armed Forces clearly proves that Pakistan had deployed F-16 fighter jets against Indian military targets in an offensive operation. Now, why is this significant to us? This is very important to India because the United States had sold the F-16 fighter jets to Pakistan on one condition, that Pakistan will never deploy F-16 in an offensive role against any target. The F-16s were meant to be used by Pakistan only in a defensive role. So the recovery of the debris and the public display by the Indian Armed Forces clearly nails the Pakistani lie that F-16s were not deployed against India. It shows the involvement of F-16s in this air-to-air combat, which resulted in a dogfight between the Indian Air Force and the Pakistani Air Force. And in this conflict, one MiG-21 Bison managed to shoot down a F-16 fighter jet. It also proves the fact that the Indian Air Force brought down a F-16 fighter aircraft, and it proves Pakistan's deployment of F-16 in an offensive role against India. The editorial coming home refers to the release of the captured Indian pilot, and the editorial says that this provides an opportunity for India and Pakistan to de-escalate tensions between the two sides. The editorial says that there has been enough evidence to show that there was substantial diplomatic pressure exerted against Pakistan to secure the release of the Indian pilot. So clearly, this is not just a gesture of goodwill from the Pakistani side. But despite that, India needs to appreciate Pakistan's decision to release Wing Commander Abhinandan, because this will finally create some space for diplomacy to take root between India and Pakistan. Because over the last 2 weeks, tensions have remained extremely high between the two countries. And finally, an opportunity has opened up due to the release of the Indian pilot. And this is the opportunity that both India and Pakistan should utilize to reduce the tensions between the two countries. Because right now, both India and Pakistan have achieved something to claim victory for their respective sides. India has already claimed a successful retaliation against the Jaish-e-Mohammed for the Pulwama terror attacks. India also managed to bring down a F-16 fighter aircraft of the Pakistani Air Force. Whereas for Pakistan, it managed to conduct a counter-attack against India. And reportedly, it even brought down a MiG-21 and it also captured the Indian pilot. This will help Pakistan to claim that it has the capability for self-defense. It has the right and the will to defend itself against India. Whereas India can also defend itself, saying that it has acted against Pakistan-sponsored terrorism. And right now, we see that the opportunity of releasing the captured pilot is also being utilized by both the sides to claim victory over one another. Pakistan has leveraged upon this opportunity, and it is labeling the event as a goodwill gesture, as a peace gesture from Pakistan. It is just trying to occupy a moral high ground. And on the other hand, India has denied that this is a goodwill gesture. Instead, India has said that this is purely being done because of the huge diplomatic pressure that India managed to exert against Pakistan. Either ways, both the sides have got enough opportunities to claim victory and to project this opinion onto their domestic audience. And this opens up an opportunity for diplomatic steps to be taken, which will help in reducing tensions between the two countries. In fact, the editorial tries to strike a note of caution over here, It says that there have been enough developments over the last 2.5 weeks which threaten to bring two nuclear-powered rivals to the brink of conflict. We had the Pulwama terror attacks, then India's counter-strike against Jaish-e-Mohammed at Balakot, then Pakistan responded with an aerial attack against India, and the Indian pilot was captured. And all these events had the potential to result in the breakout of a full-fledged conventional war between India and Pakistan. And the editorial criticizes the role played by political leaders on both the sides and as well as the role played by the media on both the sides. Because political leaders and as well as the media in both India and Pakistan have promoted the hysteria of war in order to appeal to their domestic audience and to score brownie points over such a sensitive issue. So now the time has come for both India-Pakistan to keep aside the issues and make use of the opportunity of the release of the pilot and set up diplomatic initiatives to deal with terrorism and ensure that terror sanctuaries are wiped out from Pakistan. This is where the editorial says that Pakistan cannot continue to live in a denial mode. It can't deny that terror sanctuaries exist in the country. It can't deny its connections with terror outfits. Because right now, India has managed to win international public opinion and most governments are supportive of India's efforts. And this is where Pakistan needs to act on these terror groups. And Pakistan should also keep in mind the state of its current economy. And the editorial says that such an arrangement can be worked out. There is potential for this to happen because we have seen a similar precedent in the past. Because back in 2003, the then Pakistani president, Pervez Musharraf, had decided to act on the terror groups at least for a short period of time. This came after a series of tense events between India and Pakistan. It started with the hijacking of the Indian aircraft in 1999. Then around the same period, we had nuclear explosions by both the countries. We had the Kargil conflict, the attacks on the Indian parliament, and as well as Operation Parakram, which brought India-Pakistan to the brink of conflict. But despite such extreme tensions, there was significant international pressure exerted on both India-Pakistan, which pushed the countries to negotiate, and Pakistan's economy had taken a severe hit. This is what forced Pervez Musharraf in 2003 to take some limited action against terror outfits. This led to a slight improvement in relations between India and Pakistan, and it managed to bring down the acts of terrorism against India at least by a slight margin. And we have an article on page 11 which provides a great insight into the back-channel diplomatic efforts which have put a lot of pressure on both India and Pakistan in order to reduce the tensions between the two countries. It refers to a series of calls and visits which have been carried out by the representatives of the government of United States, Saudi Arabia and United Arab Emirates. And most likely, these calls and visits would have exerted pressure on Pakistan, especially on Prime Minister Imran Khan, and this might have pushed Pakistan to release Wing Commander Abhinandan as soon as possible. Pakistan might claim this as a goodwill gesture, but clearly there is quite enough evidence to show that there was diplomatic pressure exerted on the government to ensure the release of the Indian pilot. Because if the captured Indian pilot was not released, this would have put greater pressure on India, especially domestic public pressure, and India might have been forced to escalate the crisis. And reportedly, these countries have been trying to ensure that India doesn't take any steps which will escalate the tensions further. Because the breakout of a conflict between India and Pakistan is not in the interest of the United States, Saudi Arabia, and as well as UAE. Even Russia, European Union, and as well as China have similar concerns. So on the back channel, some sort of diplomatic pressure would have been exerted on Pakistan to ensure the immediate release of the captured Indian pilot. Similar pressure would have been brought upon India as well to ensure that there is no further escalation in tensions from the Indian side. And we have another article on page 11 which talks about the details of the dossier that India has handed over to Pakistan. Reportedly, the dossier contains evidence to link Jaish-e-Mohammed with the Pulwama terror attack. It has enough evidence to show the activities of Jaish-e-Mohammed on Pakistani soil and its role in conducting acts of terrorism against India. Even though Jaish-e-Mohammed is a proscribed terrorist outfit in Pakistan, it has continued to operate very freely since 2002. Because Pakistan had banned the organization and it had declared it as a terrorist organization in 2002. But despite that, the outfit continues to operate very freely. Masood Azhar and other top leaders of the outfit, they conduct multiple rallies in the open. They hold religious conferences and they attempt to carry out religious radicalization in order to recruit fighters for the outfit. And there is enough information available both with intelligence agencies across the world and as well as in the public domain to show that the organization is based out of Pakistan, the leaders are present in Pakistan, and there are terror camps which are located inside Pakistan. So these details have been listed out by India in the dossier which has been handed out. And the Jaish-e-Mohammed even runs a blog where it openly claims acts of terrorism against India. So all these details have been listed out along with India's intelligence reports to force Pakistan to take some sort of credible and verifiable action against the Jaish-e-Mohammed. But we also need to remember that India has handed out many such dossiers in the past, especially after 26/11. India gave out many dossiers with regard to the activities of the Lashkar-e-Taiba and as well as Jamaat-ud-Dawah. India tried to pinpoint Hafiz Saeed and other top leaders of the outfit. But despite such evidence being handed over, Pakistan has taken very limited action against these leaders and these organizations. And we have an update on one of the topics which was discussed in yesterday's analysis. Since the last few days, we have been closely following the Supreme Court judgment with regard to the Forest Rights Act, because the judgment had triggered a major controversy. The Supreme Court had ordered the eviction of scheduled tribes and other traditional forest dwellers whose claims for land rights had been rejected as per the provisions of the Forest Rights Act of 2006. We have already discussed the controversy a number of times. Please go back and watch yesterday's analysis. And the central government had filed an appeal in front of the Supreme Court asking for it to reconsider the judgment. So yesterday, the Supreme Court has decided to stay its eviction order because the central government managed to convince that due process of law was not followed by the state governments and the Gram Sabhas. And as a result, if the tribal communities and forest dwellers, if they are evicted from their native lands, this would represent the violation of principles of natural justice and a complete miscarriage of justice. Now let's take up another article from page 1. The Union Cabinet has approved the Jammu and Kashmir Reservation Amendment Ordinance, which proposes to provide for reservation in the field of jobs, promotions, and as well as with regard to education. And these provisions are available to the people who are living just 10 kilometers from the international border in the Jammu region. The proposal was brought up by the Governor's Administration of Jammu and Kashmir, because currently the state is under President's rule, and that's the reason why the proposal had to be approved by the Union Cabinet. And the reason for providing these special benefits to people who reside within 10 kilometers from the international border in Jammu is because people in this region are also affected by shelling and heavy firing which comes from across the border. So due to constant border hostilities between India and Pakistan in the Jammu region, the people are constantly on the move and their welfare gets compromised. And as a result, people in the region are socio-economically backward and they are educationally backward. So with the intention of assisting this community, the government has approved the provision of reservation, and this has been done through the ordinance route. So when the proposal was made, there was a lot of controversy going around that the government is attempting to alter Article 35A and Article 370 of the Indian Constitution. And after approving the ordinance, the Union Cabinet has clearly said that it doesn't affect Article 35A or 370 of the Indian Constitution. Article 35A of the Indian Constitution is a controversial provision which was introduced in 1954 through presidential order. Essentially, the provision was added by amending the Constitution without following the due process of amendment as prescribed in the Constitution. It was not the Indian Parliament which introduced the provision. Instead, it was introduced through the presidential order route as provided by Article 370. By using the powers of Article 370, by passing a presidential order, Article 35A was added to the Indian Constitution. And what does this article deal with? It basically provides for special provisions to the state of Jammu and Kashmir. According to this article, the state government has the power to define permanent residents of the state, and only those who are eligible to be defined as permanent residents, they will enjoy few special privileges. So based on the definition of permanent residents given by the state government, special privileges will be extended to the permanent residents. This extends to the area of jobs, education, acquiring property in the state, acquiring scholarships, etc. So those who are not defined as permanent residents, they will not access these special privileges. They are available only to the permanent residents as provided by Article 35A. And Article 370 was added to the Indian Constitution to provide for certain special provisions to the state of Jammu and Kashmir, considering the difficult circumstances under which the state became a part of the Indian Union. Similarly, we have special provisions for other states in the Northeast as well. So Jammu and Kashmir gets special provisions under Article 370, and the state government of Jammu and Kashmir has already extended reservation to various communities in the state, and special reservation is already available to people who reside within 10 kilometers of the line of control, because the line of control, which is under the control of the Indian Army, witnesses heavy shelling and heavy firing in the region. So only people residing in this region were eligible for reservation in jobs, promotion and education. But people residing near the international border, which is present in Jammu, which is guarded by the BSF, they were not eligible for any special reservation. So right now a new provision has been introduced, and the Union Cabinet has approved the ordinance to provide a similar reservation, which is already available around the LOC, to people residing around the international border as well. Now let's take up the last article for the day. The second meeting of the Asian Rhino Range countries has come to an end with the adoption of the New Delhi Declaration. And the countries where the Asian rhinoceros is found, they have come to an agreement under the New Delhi Declaration to ensure that international boundaries will not come in the way of conservation of rhinoceros. Because most of the rhinos found in Asia, they are transboundary in nature. They tend to cross over international boundaries. And this creates jurisdictional issues when it comes to conservation and protection of the Asian rhinoceros. So in order to ensure that international boundaries will not come in the way of rhinoceros conservation, the New Delhi Declaration has decided to take a few steps in this regard. And the article carries a few important points for your prelims. It talks about the one-horned rhinoceros, or also called as the Indian rhinoceros. This species of the Asian rhinoceros is native to the Indian subcontinent, and it is found in India, Nepal, and in Bhutan. And its current IUCN status is listed as vulnerable. The Indian rhinoceros is a one-horned rhinoceros, and it is naturally found only in India and in Nepal. But some of the rhinoceros, they tend to cross over into Bhutan as well. That's the reason why even Bhutan is considered as a part of the conservation program. Especially the rhinos which are found in the Manas National Park, which is present in the state of Assam, and as well as rhinos found in the Buxa Tiger Reserve, which is found in the state of West Bengal. These rhinos, they generally cross over into Bhutan as well, and that's the reason why the country has been included under the conservation program. And the most important range for the one-horned rhinoceros is the Kaziranga National Park in Assam, because the Kaziranga National Park is home to nearly 2,938 one-horned rhinoceros out of the 3,584 rhinoceros which is found in India and in Nepal. This is the major habitat for the Indian rhinoceros. And the article also mentions the Sumatran rhinoceros. It is currently listed as critically endangered by the IUCN. This is the smallest of all the rhinoceros species, and this is the only Asian rhinoceros which has two horns, just like the African rhinoceros. Historically, the Asian rhinos were found across China, across India, Bangladesh, and as well as across Southeast Asia. But unfortunately today, Their habitat has been severely restricted. They are hardly found in few areas of India and Nepal, and they are found in few parts of Malaysia and Indonesia. In fact, the Sumatran rhinoceros has already gone extinct in Malaysia, and there are only a few remaining individuals which are present in Indonesia. So these countries, they want to replicate the conservation model that India has used with regard to the Indian rhinoceros. And you have a third type of Asian rhinoceros known as the Javan rhinoceros. Even this is listed as critically endangered according to the IUCN. So the Southeast Asian countries have decided to follow India's model to protect and conserve the Asian rhinos. If you look at the Kaziranga National Park, in 1905, the area had hardly around 10 Indian rhinos left. But once it was declared as a protected area, and once the Indian government started taking conservation measures, the number of rhinos have started increasing in the wild. Today, the Kaziranga National Park has majority of the rhinos which are found in India and Nepal. This clearly shows the success of the conservation program that India has run. And India works very closely with Nepal to provide for transboundary protection of the one-horned rhinoceros. And the article mentions the National Rhino Conservation Strategy of India. Please take this up as an assignment and read the basic provisions of the National Rhino Conservation Strategy. And also take note of other important habitats where the Indian rhinoceros can be found. Now let's take up the practice questions. Which of the following statements are correct? The United Nations Human Rights Council was established by the UN General Assembly. The headquarters of UNHRC is in Geneva, Switzerland. It replaced the UN Commission on Human Rights. All the three statements are correct. So option D is your right answer. Now please take up a map-based question. Which of the following countries is not a part of the historical range of the Indian rhinoceros? It is not asking the current range. It is asking for the historical range. The correct answer is option D, Myanmar. Historically, the Indian rhinoceros is reported to have been found in Pakistan, in India, in Nepal, and as well as in parts of Bhutan and Bangladesh. But there are no records to show the animal to be found in Myanmar. Now let's take up a question from the 2015 prelims paper. In India, the steel production industry requires the import of which ingredient? The correct answer is option C, coking coal, because India does not have good quality coking coal and hence we end up importing large quantities of coking coal. So option C is the right answer. And please take up a mains practice question. Describe the range of the Indian rhinoceros and its conservation status. What measures has India taken to promote the conservation of this vulnerable species? So please try and write an answer to this question and post your answers in the comment section below. And with this, we can conclude our discussion for the day. Thanks for watching.